Father, we want to thank you, Lord, for this evening that you've given us this time to come and sit at your word and sit at your feet and learn from your word. Father, this is a time that we look forward to so eagerly every week when we can come and open the scriptures and learn what you have to say to us. Father, this evening we commit then and into your precious hands, Father. Lord, we thank you for the passion that is he has in his heart to make your word known. And Father, we thank you for all the time that he has spent sitting at your feet, studying your word, preparing so that he can share it with us. Father, this evening I pray for everyone who is here. Lord, our hearts are prone to wander. Our hearts are easily distracted. But today, Lord, we want your spirit to keep our hearts totally connected and focused on you. Father, because we believe that none of us are here by accident and that you have a message for each and everyone. And so, Father, we pray you would anoint Danan, even as he preaches, shares the word this evening. And Father, we pray that your word would find a deep root in our heart, Father, so that we may become people who live our lives in such a way that we bear the fruit of the Spirit. We ask this through your matchless name. Amen. So today we continue our series on end times. Danan, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you for joining after a week's break. Just one moment. Let me share a document. I'll do the sharing later. Okay. So they always say that it's wrong to start with an apology, but I will do so today because even though I was very keen to do the rapture and part of the tribulation period, I've decided not to touch the tribulation period today, but to start on it tomorrow, because there is so much to be shared under the rapture itself. So let me share this just to show us where we stand today. So just to give the context, we are here in the church age, right in the middle. And we have the cross, and we looked at Daniel's 70 weeks last time. Hope you remember that. It was 2 weeks ago. And the Lord was cut off. That is the cross, the Messiah or the anointed one was cut off. Then he died, rose again, and ascended into heaven. Then on the 50th day after the Passover, during which he died, on the day of Pentecost, the church age came into existence. And we looked at the seven churches. And we have believed that we are right at the end of this church age here. And soon we will go up in the rapture. So today I just want to concentrate on the rapture. And God willing, next week I will, or the next 2 weeks, let's look into this part, which is the temple of the Antichrist or the beast, the tribulation period, and the great tribulation period, Daniel's 70th week. So let's look at the rapture. I'm going to read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. So the rapture is the next great event that is to take place in God's prophetic calendar. There is nothing holding back the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is imminent. It could happen at any moment. And though we do not know the day or the hour right now, we are closer to the return of Christ than any humans have ever been in the history of the world. He is almost at the door. He will open it and he will invite us in. Now, when it comes to the rapture, there are different kinds of beliefs. Some people do not believe in the rapture and they justify it in different ways. But after spending 3.5 decades studying this, I'm even more convinced that the rapture is going to happen. Now, how do you then describe 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 to 18 that I've just read out? In the same way, how do you explain 1 Corinthians chapter 15? There are others also, there are three ways in which they believe in the rapture. Some believe in the pre-tribulation rapture. The Bible, I believe, talks about the pre-tribulation rapture, and I'll tell us why. Some believe in the mid-tribulation rapture, which means at the end of these 3.5 years, the first 3.5 years or first half of Daniel's 70th week, the rapture will take place, mid-tribulation. Some believe in the post-tribulation rapture, means at the end of the Daniel's 70th week or at the end of the tribulation. Some don't believe in the rapture at all. Some believe in the pre-tribulation, some believe in the mid-tribulation, and some believe in the post-tribulation. Now, I believe in that the pre-tribulation rapture is the correct one. Why? There are many reasons. Why? Because when we study the book of Revelation very carefully, or even when we talk about the tribulation that is mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, in the Gospel of Luke, and also in Mark, in the Olivet Discourse, nowhere is the church mentioned in the tribulation. Nowhere does the Bible talk about the church getting caught to the tribulation. You can search the scriptures, you won't find that. In all the writings of the New Testament authors, notably Paul, who was the most prolific writer, then Peter, then you have John and James, and whoever wrote Hebrews, none of them ever mention about the church getting caught to the rapture. Nowhere is it told that the believers will go through the tribulation age. Why? Because the church has already, or the members of the church have already been judged at Calvary. Now remember, the purpose of the tribulation is judgment. The 7 years of real bad tribulation, 7 years of struggle that's going to come upon this world, the whole purpose is for judgment. And we have already been judged, our sins have been judged on the cross at Calvary. And also, finally, in Revelation chapter 19, we see the church in heaven during the tribulation. In other words, in chapters 2 and 3 of Revelation, you see the church here on earth, the seven church ages, starting from Ephesus right down to Laodicea. The church is here on earth. After the third chapter, with the fourth chapter, the tribulation is introduced. You don't see the church here on earth. So from chapter 4 to chapter 18 of Revelation, church is not mentioned on earth. And in chapter 19, you see the church in heaven. So I believe that at the end of the church age, which is end of chapter 3, in Revelation between the end of chapter 3 and the beginning of chapter 4, the rapture takes place. And your question is, would be, why do we need the rapture? There are reasons for that. Firstly, to resurrect the dead believers. Now, we just read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and also in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we notice that the Lord Jesus comes to resurrect the believers who are dead. And that gives us hope. So this was one of the passages that I have been spending time with ever since my mom died 2 months ago. And, you know, we have hope. Even as I see her mortal remains being buried, I was rejoicing that I will see her again, and that this body will be raised up. The body that we have is going to be raised up, even though we die. So one of the purposes of the rapture is to resurrect dead believers. Second one. The second purpose of the rapture is to resurrect believers who are alive. And Paul writes so clearly in this passage that we read that when we die, that we will be resurrected. If we are alive, we will also be resurrected. So if the Lord should come now, we first, those who have dead in Christ will rise up, then we will be resurrected. The rapture is also, thirdly, to judge Christians for rewards. Now remember, I'll see if I can show you another diagram. One moment. Give me one moment, please. No, it's the same picture. Never mind. Let me explain here. Now, after the rapture of the church, there are going to be two judgments. The first judgment is for believers, for us Christians, and that judgment is not for sin, because our sins have already been judged at Calvary. And now, because we have placed our trust in the Lord Jesus, his death has covered our sins. So we will be judged for rewards. Then, at the end of the millennium age, if you see at the right corner of this, right-hand corner of this diagram, at the end of the millennium age, we will have the white throne judgment, or the great white throne judgment, that is for unbelievers, that is to judge them for their sins. So remember, we believers also will be judged for our sins, for our rewards, and the unbelievers will be judged for their sins, because we believers have already been judged for our sins at Calvary. Now, the Bible also talks about two resurrections. Now that we are talking about the rapture and the resurrection, the Bible speaks about two resurrections. Now, by way of information, the first mention of resurrection in the Bible is found in Daniel chapter 12, the last chapter of Daniel, verse 2. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. That's the first mention of the resurrection in the Bible. Now, the Bible also talks about two resurrections. In chapter 20 of Revelation, verses 4 and 5, the Lord talks about the resurrection of those who had died. And he talks about the first resurrection. And then later on, he talks about the second resurrection. Now, the first resurrection is for believers. The second resurrection is for unbelievers. So remember, every single human being from Adam to the last baby to be born into this world will be resurrected. Believers will take part in the first resurrection. Unbelievers will take part in the second resurrection. When will the believers' resurrection will take place? It is generally done in four parts. The first resurrection happens in four parts. The first of the first resurrection is what we call as Easter Sunday or Resurrection Sunday. This is the resurrection of Christ. He is the first fruits of all those who rose from the dead. Now, you may argue that there were people who were resurrected before Christ, but remember, none of them lived forever. They died again. For example, Lazarus was resurrected, he died again. But the Lord was the first to rise up from the dead, never to die again. So the first part of the first resurrection is the resurrection of Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:23, Christ the first fruits. Then, second part of the first resurrection is the rapture of the body of Christ. That's the event that we are waiting for. That is also part of the first resurrection, but it is the second part of the first resurrection. We read about that in 1 Thessalonians 4:13 to 18. Then the third part of the second resurrection is right there in the middle. Can you see the tribulation period? And You see, 3.5 years and 3.5 years. Right in the middle, at the end of the 3.5 years, according to Revelation chapter 11, God sends two witnesses. They will go all over the world proclaiming the gospel and winning souls during the tribulation age. The beast will finally be allowed to kill them, and their bodies will rot on the streets of Jerusalem for 3 days. Then what happens? They will suddenly be resurrected. That's right here in the middle. So if you can see this diagram, you can see the cross. Just after the cross was the first part of the first resurrection, Christ. Then the rapture here, the long arrow, that is the second part of the first resurrection. Third one will be right in the middle, right in the middle of the tribulation age, the two witnesses will be resurrected. Then Revelation chapter 20 talks about the resurrection of the tribulation saints, that is the believers of this age, people who became believers during the tribulation, the 7-year tribulation period. Some of them will die and be martyred. They will be resurrected at the end of the tribulation age. So you can see that the first resurrection of believers happens in 4 stages. But one question we have, the Bible doesn't directly tell us, is when do the Old Testament believers, when are they resurrected? The Bible doesn't tell us. Obviously, they were not resurrected at the time of Christ's resurrection, though some tombs were opened, and in Matthew records that some of the dead believers were seen in Jerusalem. At the rapture, the Old Testament believers are not resurrected, because it's very clear that the rapture is for the body of Christ. Christ comes to take his body, which is only the church. And when the two witnesses are raised up in the middle of the tribulation age, the Bible specifically says that they are the only two who are resurrected. Most likely, the Old Testament believers will be resurrected with the tribulation saints at the end of the tribulation period. So this is the first resurrection. This is for all believers. It happens in 4 parts. Once again, it happens Easter Sunday, the death, the resurrection of Christ. He was the first fruits. Rapture, the church, middle of the tribulation period, the two witnesses, end of the tribulation period, the tribulation saints, and perhaps the Old Testament saints. Then, at the end of the millennium age, can you see here, you have the millennium, 1,000 years, just before that, before eternity, that will be the second resurrection. And that is mentioned in Revelation chapter 20. And we see that death and Hades will give up their dead. The seas will give up their dead. So from Adam's time, all unbelievers who died, they also will be resurrected. Their bodies will be resurrected, and they will be judged here at this point, just before eternity, and then cast into a lake of fire. Revelation 20, verses 11 to 15. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. Earth and sky fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire, and the lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. So these are the two resurrections that are mentioned in the Bible. First one, the first resurrection, happens in 4 parts. It is for all believers. Then the second resurrection happens at once, and that is for all unbelievers. Now, before we proceed, I just want to share a thought. I did share this at an evening service, and I'm sure some of you were not there, and if you were there, you might have forgotten this. Let me just give me one moment to share that little diagram. Sorry, I need to go a bit further here. Just bear with me. It's an interesting thought. Right. Now, just hear me out. Now, there are seven feasts in Judaism. Four of them take place in springtime, which is between the months of March to May. Remember, because they follow a lunar calendar, you know, their dates keep changing. We follow normally in the secular world, we follow the solar calendar. So 25th of December is always 25th of December. But their dates keep changing. That's why the Passover dates keep changing. And we follow the lunar calendar to fix our Good Friday and Easter and all. That's why those dates also keep changing. So four feasts of Judaism happen in the springtime, that is March to May. Then three feasts of Judaism happen in September to October in autumn. Why spring and autumn? Because the winter is very cold and it even snows in Jerusalem. And summer, as you know, Middle East is horribly hot. You know, it'll be like 45 degrees, sometimes it goes near 48 degrees. So all the festivals are during the more pleasanter time of the year. The Lord, you know, gave it to them like that. So I'm going to teach us something interesting. Just think about it. You may disagree with me. So the four feasts of springtime, March to May, have been fulfilled in the first coming of Christ. Now, remember these seven feasts given to us in the Bible, they all looked forward to Calvary and to the Lord, his work, his person, everything. Now, hear me out. The first four feasts of springtime are Pesach, which is Passover, the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, the Feast of the First Fruits, and the Feast of Pentecost. Now, these four have been fulfilled on that very day. All of them were fulfilled on that very day in the first coming of Christ. Remember, the year that the Lord died, most likely 33 AD, the Bible tells us in the Gospel of John that it was a special Sabbath. Special Sabbath means where the Passover falls on the Sabbath. That's called a special Sabbath. Why was that a special Sabbath? Because it was the most special Sabbath, because the Lamb of God was finally being sacrificed for our sins. So the Passover represents the crucifixion. Christ, our Passover Lamb, was sacrificed for us. That was fulfilled on the day of the Passover. Then the Saturday, the day, the Sabbath day after the Passover is the day of the unleavened bread, the feast of the unleavened bread. And that's the Sabbath or Saturday, the body of the Lord was resting in the tomb. The children of Israel are supposed to rest on the unleavened bread, day of the unleavened bread or the feast of the unleavened bread. On that day, the body of Christ was resting in the tomb. Then the first day of the week after the Passover, which is Sunday, is the feast of the first fruits. They harvest the first fruits and they go and wave either barley or wheat. They go and wave it in the presence of the Lord in front of the temple. And the resurrection of Christ is referred to as the first fruits. I even read it out to us. So that happened on the same day while the priests were waving the sheaf of barley or wheat, the Lord Jesus rose again from the tomb. Then the Feast of the Pentecost is on the 50th day. Pente is five, so multiplication of five. On the 50th day after the Passover, the crucifixion of Christ was the Pentecost. On that day, the church came into existence with the Spirit of God coming down. So what I want you to see is at the first coming of Christ, these four springtime festivals, what they looked forward to, what they portrayed, what they were a shadow or picture or type of the events in the ministry of Christ were fulfilled on that very day. Now we go to the autumn festivals. You know this? The three things that the autumn festivals look forward to or typify or shadow, prefigure, have not yet taken place. These will take place at the coming of the Lord. So first we have the Feast of Trumpets, and that symbolizes the rapture. Why? In that passage we read, with the trumpet call of God, with the voice of the archangel, with a great shout, the dead in Christ shall rise first. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. So, next one, the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. This would symbolize the second coming of Christ, Revelation chapter 19, and the end of the 7-year tribulation period. The Lord comes to deliver his people. Then finally, the Feast of Tabernacles. Tabernacles, the word of God tells us that God tabernacled amongst us. He dwelt amongst us. That symbolizes the beginning of the millennial rule, the 1,000-year rule of Christ. So what I'm trying to say is this. I'm not trying to fix a date. But if the first four feasts, the springtime feasts, referred to his first coming, and they all happened on that exact day, not one day this way, one day that way, it is likely that the second coming also will happen on this day. So the rapture might happen on the Day of Trumpets, which is generally in our calendar, September, October. That doesn't mean that in August you sleep and then September you get ready for the rapture. No, it can happen anytime. But if that same principle applies, the rapture might take place in September, October. The Day of Atonement, the second coming of the Lord and the end of the tribulation will also take place September, October. And the Feast of Tabernacles, that is the beginning of the millennial rule of Christ, might also take place around September, October. A good point to think about. I'll leave that, with you. Right. Then, going back to these diagrams. Right. Now, after the rapture, what happens? Obviously, the tribulation happens, but it'll take place after some time. There might be a small gap of a few days or perhaps a month or two before the tribulation happens. Now, sometimes we think that, the rapture happens today on the 2nd of February and tomorrow the tribulation starts. No, I will explain it, God willing, next Tuesday when we meet, because it is very clear that certain things have to happen after the rapture, and then only the tribulation period will start. There is a possibility that the tribulation period can also start maybe a year later, or a couple of years later, or 2 or 3 years after the rapture of the church. Why do I say that? I'll explain it more clearly next time. But it is very clear that at the time of the rapture, the beast or the Antichrist will not be known. But he will come up fast, but he won't come up in 1 or 2 days. He'll take a couple of months or years to come up. And then finally, he will sign an agreement. The nations of the world will sign an agreement to protect Israel, and he will confirm that covenant. Means the beast or the Antichrist will put his final signature. That's the point at which he will be revealed as the Antichrist to the world. So, in the meantime, the rapture has taken place. We have all gone to heaven. What next? The world is getting ready for the beast, and the beast is suddenly coming into power, coming into prominence. While that is happening, what happens is we are up there and we are going through a serious review of our lives in heaven. Means every believer will stand in the presence of God, and the Lord Jesus sitting on what is known as the Bema seat. That was the seat on which judges sat in the Greek culture. And the Lord Jesus will be our Bema judge. He will sit, it's called the judgment seat of Christ. He will sit at the judgment seat and he will judge us for our rewards. Remember, our sins have been forgiven, but he will judge us for our rewards. Now, there are some misconceptions about this. Some people think that since our sins are forgiven, there will not be a serious review of our lives. That is wrong. Even though sins are forgiven, God will review the lives of every believer. Some people think that we are saved by faith. So good works are of no use in God's kingdom. No. In Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10, we are clearly told, by grace you have been saved through faith. And it goes on to say, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared us in advance to do. Means good works don't save us, but the purpose of our salvation is to do good works. So God will reward us for our good works. And finally, some people think that, doing good works or working for a reward is being selfish. Of course, we must be driven by love to do service. We must be driven by love to serve the Lord and to serve our fellow believers and fellow humanity. But since the Lord has promised us, he says, I will reward you. In fact, the last words of Christ in the Bible, Revelation 22, 12, behold, I'm coming soon and my reward is with me and I will give to everyone according to what he or she has done. That's his last words. And in his last words, he's promising us a reward or rewards. So there's nothing wrong in working for those rewards. And quickly, how will the Lord judge us? It'll be a very fair judgment. It'll be a thorough judgment. It'll be an impartial judgment. You can't sway the judge by your arguments. It'll be individual judgment. Everyone will be judged individually. We can't cling on to our mothers or our fathers, but it's also a gracious judgment. God understands the challenges that we face in living for him. So, and the Lord will judge our thoughts, our intentions, our sins, our motives. Now you may say, I told you that our sins have already been judged, but this is judging our sins for rewards. So if I sin as a Christian, I do a lot of sin, then I lose my rewards. This is not to send me to hell. I'll be in heaven, but this is to give me rewards. So there are also five crowns that God has promised us. And these are for different things. Now, what are the things that God will reward us for? Quickly, this is not a complete list. Joyful acceptance of injustice. All of us are treated badly and treated unjustly by the people of this world. Sometimes it even happens in the church, in the body of Christ. But if we joyfully accept injustice, God will reward us for it. Matthew chapter 1, chapter 5. God will reward us for financial generosity. If God doesn't have our purse or our wallet, he doesn't have our heart. We have to willingly be generous financially towards God's ministry, towards those who are poor in the body of Christ, even the poor that are outside. Hospitality, Matthew 25. When we show hospitality to those who can't repay us, God will reward us for that. God will reward us for our spiritual disciplines, Matthew chapter 6. Prayer, Bible study, then praise, worship, service of the Lord, fellowship with other believers, encouraging other believers. These are spiritual disciplines and God will reward us for that. He will also reward us for the faithfulness in our jobs, in our vocation. Colossians chapter 3. You know, if we work, we must work as we are doing it unto the Lord, not because we want a salary or we want a promotion. Then God will also reward us for loving the unlovable. It's always easy to love those who are lovable, but difficult to love the unlovable. Luke chapter 6. Then God will reward us for doctrinal integrity. 2 John verses 7 and 8. If we keep a pure doctrine, God will reward us for that. God will also reward us for investing in people. Christianity is not a creed. It is not a religion. It's not just a faith system. It is not a denomination. No, all these are man-made. Christianity is about relationships, our relationship with God and his relationship with us and our relationship with those around us. So when we invest in people, we mentor people, we disciple people, think of Sunday school teachers, think of youth leaders, think of those who do pastoral care. God will reward us for that. Also, 2 Timothy 4:8, those who are awaiting the return of the Lord, who are eagerly awaiting the Lord to come back. Another one, 1 Peter chapter 1, acceptance of suffering. You know, without complaining, we accept suffering with a glad heart. So these are some of the things by which God, for which God will discipline. I want to end with this. Now, basically, the basis on which the Lord will judge us for rewards is, one, our motives. Secondly, our faithfulness. You know, nowhere does God tell us to be successful. It tells us to be faithful. So, why are we serving? Are we serving to become popular? Are we serving because you feel nice? Or are we serving because we want to get rich? Think of all these false prophets of our age. It's all money in their ministry. They're all billionaires and they want more and more money. And all their sermons are about giving money to seed money to their, you know, their church or whatever. Then no rewards. The motive must be because we love the Lord and because we love our fellow human beings. Motives are important. Wrong motive, no rewards in heaven. Secondly, faithfulness. This is where most of us will fail. Faithfulness means you continue with the task that God has given to you. And you don't give up until you finish the task or until the Lord removes you from this earth or until the Lord takes the task away from you. Whatever big or small, God gives you a task or God gives you tasks, you must be faithful to it. You don't give up. You go on until it is no longer possible. And for faithfulness, you are rewarded. Nowhere in the Bible do I see that success is rewarded, because success is to do with the Lord. He takes all the credit for it. We take the credit for the faithfulness. So then, as you know, there are 5 crowns, different crowns for different things. One is if you are in pastoral care, you look after your flock. One is for overcoming trials and going through the trials victoriously. One is for overcoming temptation. One is for soul winning. And the final one is for awaiting the return of the Lord, living in the expectation of the Lord's return. These are the 5 crowns. So this is what I wanted to share today. I will stop sharing and I'll put my video on so that you can ask questions.
Dr. Krishantha, you're muted.
Okay. So you say that we, because we believe in Christ, we are saved. We only have a judgment of rewards. And you listed so many things where, you know, which will entitle us to get some rewards. But while being saved, while being believing Christ, most of us probably will be guilty of certain sins as well. Some may be adultery, some may be cheating, some may be, you know, playing out the tax man. So does that mean that we are saved? We'll be rewarded according to what good we have done. But on the other side, on the negative side, we have done so much of wrong, we don't have any consequences to face. That's my question.
Good question. Let me answer that. Now, the Bible clearly teaches us that the blood of Christ is able to cleanse us completely and utterly. So your question is, what about believers who sin after being saved?
Yeah.
Now, if you study the scripture very clearly, every single one of us sin every day of our lives, even after we are saved. Every single one of us. Why? Sin is not just disobeying God. Sin is missing the mark, missing the standard of God. And God's standard is way up. Every single day, every single one of us will miss the mark. That is sin. That's why it's important to keep a short account, keep repenting, and keep overcoming such sins little by little. And that's what we mean by growing into Christ-likeness. That's what we mean by, you know, becoming practically holier over a period of time. So if I'm out of 100%, the day I got saved, I was, say, 20% practically holy. When I die, if I'm 90%, I have not lived my life in vain. Because we don't overcome sin just like that. Sometimes we struggle with it for years before we overcome. But the more we yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit, He will allow us to overcome. But none of us will reach 100% practical holiness because we are still in a sinful world. We are still with this sinful body. And we still have the old Adamic nature till we die. So what about Christians who sin? All of us. Don't we lose our salvation? No. If we have to not sin in order to keep our salvation, none of us will be saved. So what about consequences for our sins? Even though our sins are forgiven, there are consequences for our sins. Two. One is kind of earthly consequence. Say, for example, I go and rob a bank, I go and murder somebody, and I get caught. I can be sentenced to death or life imprisonment or even 10 or 15 years in jail. That is the earthly consequence. With God, what are the consequences? Now, two things. One, in this life, there'll be a loss of blessings. One, or many things. Loss of blessings. If we keep on sinning and we do not repent. Two, very clear from the scriptures that if we keep on sinning and bringing the name of the Lord into disrepute, God will also take us away sooner than He had originally planned. Paul writes to the Corinthians, because of this, some of you are asleep. There he means asleep, there means death. So he might even remove us early. Third one is, in Hebrews chapter 13, we are told that those whom I love, I will chastise or I will discipline. Now, I will discipline my children because I love them, but I won't discipline somebody else's children because, you know, I don't love them as much. So, the Lord disciplines His children who step out of line. But that doesn't mean that the moment I sin, God will jump and immediately jump down from heaven and catch me and give me a good whacking. No. God is patient, and a lot of Christians think that you can keep on sinning and God will keep quiet. No, suddenly one day, the disciplining hand of God will come, and it can be very severe, depending on how much disrepute we bring the Lord's name into. For example, it can be a serious physical illness. It can be a loss of a serious relationship. It can be loss of wealth. It can be loss of a job, you know, loss of opportunities. So God will discipline us. Again, not because He's, you know, waiting to thrash us, but through the disciplining process, He wants us to repent and come back. So these are the consequences here. But the greatest consequence would be this, loss of rewards in heaven. Why is that the greatest consequence? Because the primary reason is this. Whatever we have here is only for a few years. But the eternal rewards are, remember, eternal. They are forever. So this might come as a shock to some of us. In hell, not everyone will be punished the same way because the Bible says they'll be judged according to their sin. In the same way, in heaven, not everyone will be equal. But don't think that it'll be like the inequality that we find here in this world, where the ones who are higher up will, you know, suppress the ones who are below them. That won't happen in heaven. But in heaven, there'll be different, 1 Corinthians 15 very clearly shows that there'll be different degrees of glory. The stewardship parables teach us that there'll be different degrees of responsibility and authority and power. In other words, in heaven, we will not be sitting on a cloud playing a stringed instrument and wasting away eternity. In heaven, we'll be working, we'll be doing things, It's like the human society here without sin, which means there'll be those who are faithful here will be given responsibilities there. Remember, like Joseph, because he was faithful to God, God lifted him up here on this planet to a good high position. In the same way, in heaven, God will reward us. So these rewards are not just crowns on our heads and we are walking around with these crowns. No, these rewards are responsibilities, authority, position, glory, and perhaps the joy and enjoyment in heaven. Some will have it more than the others. It's a lengthy answer, but it's a good question.
So basically, does that mean that for whatever sin you do here, it'll be a debit against the rewards that you are getting? In other words, you have consequences there, because the way you worded it at the beginning, I thought, well, what you said is, it's only a judgment of rewards. No, it's not a judgment of punishment. So it's a case of getting rewarded for what you have done, no consequence for as a debit for what wrong you had done. You know, that was my point of confusion.
Yes, correct. The loss of rewards will be terrible, because you know, only at the end of the book of Revelation, we are told that God will wipe away all their tears. So I remember reading a book written by John R. Rice, where he clearly explains and says, the title of the book is Tears in Heaven. Now, it's important for us to realize that we can feel sad in heaven for the loss of our rewards and the opportunities that we had here by wasting away our lives, either by sinning or by doing other things. So God is rewarding us for our faithfulness. And an important point that you raised, I'll put it this way. Every day that we live here on earth is either a day of gain or a day of loss as far as eternity is concerned. So let's say today I've obeyed the Lord, I've served him faithfully, and I've struggled against sin and I've overcome temptation. It'll be a day of reward and credit for me. It's a positive day as far as eternity is concerned. But instead of that, I got up early morning and I shouted at somebody on the road. I killed two people. I robbed a bank and I went and committed adultery and went and lied to somebody. And I cursed God. It'll be a day of loss for me as far as eternity is concerned. So every day here matters. We must live in the light of eternity. Anyone else? Only doctors are asking questions.
Anyone else?
So the pluses and minuses are very much like the Buddhist belief as well. Then, you know, you do more good than bad, then it's a plus for you.
It's like this. This is not, but in the Buddhist philosophy, that is for salvation or attaining Nibbana or Nirvana. But this is not for salvation. This is only for rewards. For salvation, pluses don't help. Our pluses don't help. The only plus is the death of Christ.
Any other questions? Okay, so if you do have questions later on, please send it to one of us in the core group, and I'm sure we can pass it on to them and so that you can answer those questions later. And may I now invite Joe to close in prayer.
Sure. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for bringing us all here on another Tuesday evening. We thank you, Lord, although we have all had tiring days, just sitting at your feet and learning your word is so refreshing, Lord Jesus. We thank you for that. We thank you for the challenging message that we heard from Danon today. There's so much to think about. Help us to always remember, Lord, that this is only a temporary home, that this is not our eternal home. And like Danam said, we should do everything that we do with eternity in mind. Help us to always remember that. Just keep that thought, Lord, at the top of our minds always. All we want to hear from you is, well done, you good and faithful servant. So I pray, Lord, that you'll help us, challenge us to work towards that every day. As we wake up, as we go through every action, every motion, help us to know that we are the body. Help us to remember that we are the body of Christ, that we are acting on your behalf. And we have to do everything with eternity in mind. Thank you, Lord, for the challenging message. I pray, Jesus, that you'll help us to keep all of these things in mind. Help us to dive deeper into this, into your word and into this book, and help us to understand everything, Lord. Although it can be confusing sometimes, we know, Lord Jesus, that you will clear everything for us. Thank you for giving us such a wonderful teacher in Dan. And I pray that you will bless him, bless his ministry, bless all his work and everything that he's involved in. We thank you, Lord, for all the time that he gives to us. We pray that you will fill him more and more as he pours out his teaching to us and so many people, Lord Jesus. Thank you again for bringing us all together. Thank you for refreshing us with your word. I pray for everyone who's gathered here on this Zoom call. I pray that you'll be with them as they go about the rest of their week. And I pray that you'll help us all to remember, Lord, that we are your representatives on this earth and that we should behave in that manner, Lord. Thank you once again for the challenging message. We thank you, Lord, for your word that is always alive. We pray that you'll bring us back next week as we continue this series, Lord Jesus. We ask all this in your mighty name. Amen.
Yeah.